Vinnie Bagwell.
Hey.
What's up? Hi. What's up? How you doing?
Really good, thanks.
That's good. I see you in here with the turtleneck sweater on. You cold?
Summer is gone in New York.
It is. It's unfortunate.
Look, for real. It's gone.
It went too fast. We saw some great things happen for you over this past year, and you know, I'm glad that you're here, you know, at the 5020 Record Studio.
Thank you.
I appreciate you dropping by. So tell us, how does your upbringing tie into your artwork?
I was born into a family of artists. I didn't know it at the time. I'm one of those little kids that could draw very well. I was visually handicapped, so I spent my early years in a visually handicapped class going to the New York Eye and Ear Infirmary to get the vision that I have, because I'm legally blind. And
wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah. And so I was one of those little kids that used to like to draw every day. And, you know, my mother would make her critiques, my father would basically applaud. And one day when I was 11, my mother asked me, why don't I just draw real people? Because like most kids, I'm doing cartoons. So the next day I started doing real people. And so pencil drawings, and then in high school, it occurred to me if I could draw, I can paint, so I started painting. And I was told early on that, you know, art wasn't really a career to go after because artists don't make any money. And so I ended up going to college for psychology, human behavior. And when I got out, you know, I found that my passion was still arts oriented. So I just looked for a mentor. I started having mentors in eighth grade. English chair was my mentor in high school, so she's responsible for my athletic writing abilities because I took a lot of English classes in high school. And then, of course, I had a mentor in college. And after college, I found another mentor who was a self-employed graphic designer. And so I learned graphic design. And so over the years, as a creative, just learning what I want to learn and then ultimately figuring out how to use what I know to work.
Wow, awesome. So at what age do you think you started really becoming an artist, the artist you are today, let's say?
As soon as they let me have a pencil.
As soon as they let you have a pencil?
Yeah, oh no, I remember arguing with my first grade teacher about letters. Like, I already knew how to write when I got to kindergarten. I mean, I learned how to read in kindergarten. So by the time I was in first grade, I wanted to do script, and we argued because I wanted to flourish my A, and I didn't want to write with the double lines, and, you know, I had my own ideas, you know, as a child. And I felt entitled to do things the way that I wanted to do them, you know, if I was allowed. So I'm going to say from the beginning of time.
Since you were placed on this earth.
Yeah, it's like I want to do some things my way.
So tell me, you know, I never asked you, where are you from originally? Where did you grow up?
I was born in Yonkers,
okay.
Here. My parents moved to Greenburg when I was 10. And so I literally grew up in Greenburg. Went away to college in Maryland and came back to Yonkers, and so I've lived here most of my life. I mean, I've lived other places too, but I've lived in Yonkers most of my life.
Got it. Okay. And so your career as a sculptor now spans how long?
I started sculpting in 1993, so that's like 29 years.
Wow. Yeah. That's older than me.
Yeah. You know, I remember being brand new, you know, I'm a painter as well. And tried sculpting just to get myself to be creative because I was blocked, and discovered that I had something, and it freaked me out. I'm like, oh, I like this. And so, of course, the big question is, how do you afford it? Because sculpting is not an inexpensive hobby.
How were you able to afford the sculpting, or how were you able to go about your career?
Oh my goodness, early on, it dawned on me that I need to double my income.
Yes.
Like, double it. In 1993, the winter of 93-94, I did 5 sculptures. I needed $35,000 more than what I was earning.
Wow.
And just imagine that you find something that you love and want to do, and now you need $35,000, like right now.
Yeah, right now.
And if you don't hurry up, what you're doing is going to get destroyed. How about that?
Mm-hmm.
So in those days, I used to cry a lot. Like, we'd be having this conversation, I'd start crying. because I really was very passionate about being able to make art. And so the question is, how can I do this? So I was living in the library because we didn't have the internet. And it was really hard figuring things out, because now you just pull out your phone and you ask a question and a cajillion answers come up. Before we had, oh my goodness, the Dewey Decimal System.
Mm-hmm.
Was it 411? And the Yellow Pages. And it was hard to figure things out. I did learn about grants. And again, having already become a writing athlete, at that time I was a newspaper columnist, so I was writing every day already.
Okay.
It occurred to me I could win grants. And then in the process of looking for people from my planet of my kind, I found the arts community in Yonkers. They were already trying to figure out how to create art for public places. And because I was a writer, they embraced me because I was the person who wrote the grants. So for instance, those stone sculptures down the pier in Yonkers,
yeah.
I wrote the proposal for that won the money for that.
Wow.
Ella was our second year project. You know, that again came from City of Yonkers, HUD Community Development Block Grant funding. You know, when I discovered that there was money to beautify, you know, I was like, okay, we're gonna win some of that. And so the idea was to come up with unusual and new ideas that the city would appreciate. So we just started brainstorming and coming up with ideas. So
did you have any help with throughout this journey of yours to connect your art with the city of Yonkers?
I'm gonna say help only because it was divine, really. You know, the first year of knowing the folks from Art on Main Street, that was the name of the organization.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote the paperwork for the IRS to do the 501c3. We incorporated. So now we're eligible for funding.
Oh, that's amazing.
And so, yeah. And so we just started throwing ideas and saying, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? What do you think about this? What do you think about that? And so there was nothing here. Mind you, Yonkers was a clean sheet of paper. All those buildings over there, nothing was here. And so, you know, I was in charge of proposing marriage to the city of Yonkers. Come on, let's get married. We want the same things. You know, you want people to come here and live here. We want jobs. And so we just kept creating these really great programs, and people were coming out the woodwork to see the kinds of things that we were doing, and the city saw the viability of art. And that was the beginning. They gave us a space on Main Street. We were originally at 49 Main Street, just above Zupas. And I used to give some phenomenal parties up in there. You know, we'd have these art exhibitions with these really, really cool parties for the opening. And Yonkers didn't have anything like that then. Of course, now we have a bunch of galleries, but you know, we were the ones who started showing the city, like, this is what a downtown should look like. You know, you have to bring culture into this space. You want to bring people, you have to create culture. And so that was the beginning of my creating programming for the city. And as the city got to know me and got to know kind of how I think and whatnot, things started happening.